the questions I'm going to be asking. I'll try to be quick.
All right, do we have Cindy? Cindy is here, but she just walked out. All right, I think we'll go ahead and get started. Welcome to the Lincoln City Council meeting of December 7th. Let's all rise for the Pledge of Allegiance, followed by a period of silent meditation.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay. In accordance with LB 898, a copy of the Open Meetings Act is posted at the back of the chamber. The order of business of the City Council is as follows. The clerk will call the items listed on the agenda under public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak on an item should come forward after the clerk reads that item. The applicant and those in favor should speak first, then those opposed. The applicant may then make one short rebuttal. Each speaker should begin by stating name, address, and whether you're speaking in favor or in opposition to the item. Testimony is limited to 5 minutes per speaker. After all public hearings, the council will vote on resolutions and items listed under third reading. On the second and last meetings of the month, immediately prior to adjournment, anyone may speak on an issue not on the agenda for that date nor planned for a future agenda. And today is not an open mic. If you need an agenda, they are outside do we not have agendas?
Mm-hmm.
We do? Okay, we're good. We have agendas. If you need a parking pass, I know Teresa has some, and we also have some in the city council offices. Let's go ahead and get started with the first item.
All right. First, I'll announce that due to the Christmas and New Year holidays, the city council will not meet on Monday, December 28th, nor on Monday, January 4th. First item, our public hearing consent agenda, items 1 through 13.
Anyone wishing to speak to any one of these items? All right, next items.
All right, if not, we can vote on these items. Items 1 through 3 were introduced by Raybould.
So moved.
Second.
Seconded by Roy. Discussion. Okay, call the roll.
Camp?
Yes.
Christensen?
Yes.
Eskridge?
Yes.
Fellers?
Yes.
Gaylor Baird?
Yes.
Lamb?
Yes.
Raybould?
Yes.
Motion carried 7-0. Items 7 through 10 were introduced by Camp.
So moved.
Second.
Carl. Discussion. Okay, call the roll.
Camp?
Yes.
Christensen?
Yes.
Eskridge?
Yes.
Fellers?
Yes.
Gaylor Baird?
Yes.
Lamb?
Yes.
Raybould?
Yes.
Motion carried 7-0. Next, then, would be our public hearing liquor resolutions. We would request those giving testimony to please come forward, raise their right hand for the clerk to administer the oath. After the oath, witnesses shall state their names and addresses. Applicants or witnesses are not required to stay for the voting session. I'll call item 14, manager application of Tyler Pop for B&R Stores, Inc., doing business as Super Saver number 11 at 5460 South 56th Street. Hi, Tyler.
Hello,
raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give is the truth as you verily believe it to be?
Yes.
Thank you. Just state your name and address.
Tyler D. Pope, Super Saver store director at 5460 South 56th Street in Lincoln. I'm applying for liquor license.
Okay. Any questions? Cindy.
Mr. Pope, I saw that you transferred from Super Saver 9 to Super Saver 11.
Yes.
So could you tell me where Super Saver 9 is?
27th of Cornhusker.
Perfect. Wanted to make sure that was the one in my district. Thank
okay.
you.
All right. Any other questions?
And
John.
I believe it's not for the license, it's for manager, is it not?
This is for manager.
Yeah. Okay. Yes, I think okay. Someone said license. Yeah.
Sorry about that.
You already have the license.
All right. No other questions? All right. Thank you, sir.
Uh-huh.
Anyone else wishing to speak to this item? Okay. Next item, please.
All right. Next is item 15, manager application of Karen Briette for Whitehead Oil Company, doing business as U-Stop number 5 at 8231 O Street, And I'll call the next one as well. It's the manager application of Douglas Larkins for White Mark Energy LLC, doing business as U-Stop number 26 at 8350 Northwoods Drive. Would you raise your right hand, Doug? Do you solemnly swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give is the truth as you verily believe it to be?
Yes.
Thank you.
Douglas W. Larkins, 3902 South 76th Street. And for the manager permits for 8350 Northwoods Drive and for Karen Burriette at 83rd and O Street.
All right, any questions? Carl.
Yeah. Doug, can you tell us about one of these stores you indicated maybe utilized for kind of training, bringing people along?
The 8350 Northwoods Drive is one of our smaller stores. It's a non-24-hour store. We have a training program for our managers that we utilize at 71st and Pioneers, but have kind of found out that they go through that. When we get them out at the store, they sometimes are a little, don't have fully trained. They're a little lost. So we're looking at using this store as maybe a next step. They'll have direct the training supervisor at 71st will oversee basically their day-to-day operations, but with a little bit more freedom as far as hiring, dealing with the employees, and dealing with some of the stuff that come up. Hopefully when they get through that, they're better prepared to run one of our stores. So.
Okay, so this is a little bit lower
volume, like I said, non-24 hours. So yeah. It's a pretty simple store to run. So okay. We're looking at using this as a training store. So that it may be one that we have a little bit more turnover as far as the manager goes there. So instead of getting a new liquor license every 6 months to a year, I'll put my name on it and I'll oversee it along with the training supervisor.
Okay, sounds good. Thank you.
Sure.
Other questions? All right. Thank you very much. All right, anyone else wishing to speak to either one of these items?
Mr. Chair, I'd move approval of all three items.
Second.
Seconded by Roy. Discussion on approval. All right, Teresa, would you please call the roll?
Mm-hmm. Camp?
Yes.
Christensen?
Yes.
Eskridge?
Yes.
Fellers?
Yes.
Gaylor Baird?
Yes.
Lamb?
Yes.
Raybould?
Abstain.
Motion carried, 6-0. Public hearing resolutions. I'll call items 17 and 18 together. They are two agreements, preliminary engineering services agreement. One is supplement number 2 and one is supplement number 3 with Alfred Benish and Company for consultant compensation for additional work necessary to complete the safety project at South Coddington Avenue and West Van Dorn Street.
Good afternoon. Council, Interim Director Thomas Schaefer, here to answer any questions that you might have on these two.
Questions on these items? Carl.
Thank you. I'm wondering why there are two items. They, to my eyes, look to be the same thing, same company and same kind of work. So why do we have two of these?
The reason that we have two of those is as we proceeded with this project, we came across an issue in the one corner where we were going to have to get into a ditch. And in working with the Corps of Engineers regarding that, they claimed jurisdiction over that as a water of the U.S. And so we had to do a wetlands delineation. It was one of the tasks that would have to be done before you could proceed with other tasks. Normally, we would come to before council and ask for that amendment to happen in a state federal process ahead of time. However, you can only identify wetlands during a certain time period of the year, which meant we needed to have it done by October 15th, or we had to wait until next spring around mid-March, 1st of April. So we went ahead and the state allows us to create a consultant work order to do that work. So we did that work early. And that's split out, and that's your amendment number 2. Amendment number 3, and the work on 2 is already complete. And amendment number 3 is all the follow-up work that has to occur after that. And so the state splits those out to define what has already been done, what is yet to be done, so that we can act on each accordingly.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions for Thomas? Lirian.
I just wanted to clarify, there was two different numbers on the fact sheet. One said it was a $51,000 change, but it was in fact a $5,100 change. Is that correct? Yeah, yes, we want to go with that lower number if we can.
Yes, that was correct.
Great.
All right, anything else? All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else wishing to speak to these items? Seeing none, next item, please.
All right, next is item 19, approving the second amendment to the interlocal agreement between the city and county to adopt new Keno Human Services Prevention Fund guidelines to replace the previously adopted guidelines by the first amendment to the interlocal agreement approved by resolution A-87598 on October 7th, 2013.
Hello, Sarah Hoyle, Lincoln Lancaster Human Services Director. The Keno funds are administered through the Human Services Office, so I'm here and happy to answer any questions, any comments you may have about that.
Questions? Carl.
It's my day. Okay. All right. I was curious about the process to award the grants, and it looked like I do some grant work sometimes, and look like kind of a short time frame. The deadline to receive the applications is in December, and you grant them in January. So how does that, is that reasonable?
So we have a committed Keno advisory committee that is dedicated to reviewing these applications. They'll review them in about 2 weeks, and we'll get the recommendations out. The application is pretty short. It's 2 to 3 pages. It's not a lot of information. It's not like a federal grant application. So there's not a lot of information to sort through, nor is it a lot for nonprofit entities to complete either.
All right, thank you.
Other questions?
Do you want to just summarize the changes for everyone?
Absolutely. The major change on this, there's some wording changes, but the major change that you'll see is it was a two-year process. And from talking with nonprofit agencies, a lot of things have changed in the nonprofit grant world for 2 years. United Way's gone to 2 years. Other things have too. And so they liked this better. When it was 1 year, it was easier for them to plan their budget around. It was easier, too, for new applicants to come through the door and be considered for funding. So that's why we moved to change it from the 2 year to the 1 year cycle.
All right, any other questions? All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Anyone else wishing to speak to this item? All right, next items.
All right, next, public hearing ordinances, second reading, and related resolutions. I'll call items 20 and 21 together. They are annexation 15011, annexing approximately 48.92 acres and adjacent O Street right-of-way on property at South 90th and O Street, and the related change of zone application for a change of zone rezoning approximately 48.92 acres from AG Agricultural to R3 Residential, designating said property as a planned unit development district, and for approval of a development plan which proposes R3, R5, and B2 uses and modifications to the zoning ordinance and subdivision regulations.
All right, anyone here to speak to this item?
I have questions for staff.
Have David come up then, since we're light on testifiers here.
David Carey with the Planning Department.
Hi, David. I'm glad to have you here and someone from the Health Department as well, Chris Schroeder. Just had a few questions on this. It's an application that involves a number of waivers or changes that none of which in of themselves are necessarily all that significant, but in their totality raised a few questions for me.
Sure.
This is an area that doesn't have very good connectivity. So as we look to develop this land and develop the city on the outskirts, there isn't a lot of possibility for people who will live in this area to get in and out of their neighborhoods. So I wanted to ask you about that. And while we do, of course, try to work with folks who want to develop property, and it's important that we do that, one of the other pieces here is an exception to sort of the pipeline distance from residential. And so the real question is, I want to hear from you guys both how comfortable you are from a public safety and a public health perspective in having the pipeline be closer to residential when there's very limited access in and out of
Sure.
a residential development. And are we good with that?
Right. Yeah, I can address the first question about connectivity and then big picture, and then Chris is available about the pipeline specifically.
Thank you both for being here.
Sure. All these issues were discussed as part of this review process. And I think in the big picture, we're looking at an area that can be served by sewer and can be developed, and we're trying to find a solution to make sure that it can get developed in the best way possible. So going into it with that perspective, we were trying to find solutions to the challenging setup here. There's a drainage way that goes through here. We have the one access point that's available on O Street, but we have some limitations on current access points. And so the site plan is set up to...
Can you show the site plan and describe it? Because again, O Street is the one access point, and that's also where the pipeline is. So if there was an accident,
correct,
people would probably not be going out that way.
Yeah, and so, and this is O Street here to get some orientation. This is 90th Street. This is the access point on O Street that is part of the project. So part of what we talked about with the review process here is that we are setting this up for another access to the west in the future, with the limitation that there are two acreage lots off the page here.
To the east.
To the east, sorry. And so we cannot get that through right now. But the idea here is that over time, if and when those lots do redevelop, that would be an opportunity to make it over to another access point onto O Street. The other idea that we've been working with is these connections to the south, which off the page to the south, further south, is not part of this review process yet. But that area is sewerable, and it's an area that is likely to be developed in the near future, not immediately, not before or at the same time as this development. But the idea is this is similar to what we do with most projects, especially when there's more land to be developed beyond the actual approval that we're talking about today, is that we set it up so that those access points could be there in the future.
But I guess my question is, how likely are they? I mean, the one on the east involves waiting for property owners to be willing to sell it involves tearing down some houses ultimately in order to facilitate that roadway. So do you have a sense of the likelihood of that ever becoming a possibility?
I think one of the property owners has expressed some interest in at least discussing that possibility. There are no plans, so it certainly would be in the future. It wouldn't be immediate. To the south, obviously we have some of the ball fields there, so we have some activity there today. But in the big picture, longer term, we have the idea that that will develop in a similar form and layout as this, as a residential suburban type of layout. So as far as in the future, I think the going south is probably the more likely nearer term development. Some decisions have to be made there. It wouldn't be immediate though. So it would be a number of years, but it's something that we do see happening in the not too distant future because it is developable land.
They talked about going to the west, but we've got State Farm there.
Correct.
Were there any conversations with State Farm about the likelihood of that western connection even being possible?
There hasn't been a direct conversation with State Farm. I think the reality with that is that, first of all, they would have to agree to some type of cross-access easement, and they may or may not be amenable to that. But the other fact is that this development itself does not abut up to that point where that access point would have to be agreed to. So it's not really an opportunity right now to go there.
So if you could just speak to why connections are important, but why you're okay with the lack of connections in this particular instance, that would give me some reassurance as I look to make a decision.
I would say that we're going to get more connections in the future, that we're setting it up so that will happen. It's a matter of timing of those connections, not if they will happen.
Okay. Hi, Chris. Thanks
kind
for
of
coming.
Also ties into my part. Chris Schroeder, Health Department. We normally do use the maximum allowable operating pressure to calculate the pipeline planning area. Mm-hmm. We do use a federal formula that accounts for the diameter and the pressure. However, in this case, we were able to meet with Black Hills Energy and verify what the current operating pressure is, because they're not operating at the maximum pressure. And they gave us a sense that they don't have any immediate plans to increase the pressure. They actually oversized this line. And that they also indicated that it would take a large commercial or industrial user for them to increase the pressure. So therefore, in the near term, in our opinion, we think that access will happen before they would need to increase the pressure. So therefore, we did use the current operating pressure, and use the same formula, and it did reduce the pipeline planning area from 154 to 109 feet.
Okay. So based on your understanding of the site plan, I understand it's not fully formed. Are there any potential residential homes that would be within that 109 foot?
Not the 109, no.
Okay. If there were you know, in the unlikely event of an emergency, what is the public health department's view on people's access out, but maybe even more importantly, emergency vehicles access in to a development like this? Is do you like to, I mean, is this, can you speak to your take on, you know, you're obviously comfortable with this. I want to hear you say why.
Sure. I guess given, you know, the one access point now, so if there was a pipeline incident on O Street, you know, people could, you know, evacuate on foot to the south. And we really feel that, again, there's no immediate plans to increase the pressure, so we feel that additional access points will happen before they would increase the pressure. Because, again, it would take a large industrial or commercial user for them to do that.
So run is the word of warning to people here.
Yes,
okay.
That's correct.
Thanks. Judy.
If I can, yeah. I'm going to share with David. Stay up, Dave. Judy Halstead, Lincoln Lancaster County Health Department. In response to your question with Lincoln Fire and Rescue, Lincoln Fire and Rescue is a wonderful responder for our community. They'll continue to be a wonderful responder, but they will also respond to where they need to be, regardless of whether there is road access or not. And if that means that they're driving across yards, they're going to drive across yards. If we were to have this type of a disastrous explosion in our community, it would be a significant all-out event. And they wouldn't worry really about that kind of access. We would want to make sure that we had folks exiting on foot if they could to the south and try to get LFR in however they would need to get in to help with that. Obviously, Black Hills would have to come in. They'd be the source of that pipeline that would have to be shut down. And so they would obviously have to get access any way they could get in to do that as well.
So bottom line, ideal to have roads. Not absolutely necessary to have roads.
Well, in that type of an instance, they're going to get there however they need to. Similar to San Bruno, California, they didn't worry about where the roads were because in an explosion, roads actually can get blown up and the infrastructure itself would not be there. So they're going to get there however they need to, and they'll respond in the best capacity they possibly can.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you all.
All right. Any other questions for staff? I believe our applicant's here.
Good afternoon, Mike Eckert with Civil Design Group, here today on behalf of Lewis Strosky, Inc., the developer of this project. Apologize, Steve Hendricks and I were meeting upstairs and we underestimated how fast you'd get through the agenda.
We're efficient.
We're here and I was listening to the pipeline issues and access issues, and I know those have been questions that you've asked, Commissioner. And so, and I don't know how much you covered on the access points and our attempt to get the other access points and the discovery that the stub in from the Hillcrest neighborhood is now in the floodway. There's another stub in the Hillcrest neighborhood further to the south. When and if the YMCA soccer field area owned by Lincoln Public Schools would ever develop. And then we've also been in consultation with State Farm on the potential to go through them on that phase. But there's not a platted public road through their property. And so this has been a difficult piece in terms of the connectivity issues, but we're also designing the entry off of what would be 90th Street off of O Street is kind of a median divided. So there's gonna be a lot of width and two different lanes. And I think the propensity of an auto accident or something that might affect emergency vehicles entering is obviously higher than something actually happening with the pipeline. Black Hills has never had an incident on their pipelines, and we've talked about this with the health department. And if you look at the risk percentage, it is extremely low that there would ever be an event there. And I think more so with the pipeline in this case too, when we met with we had the Black Hills officials and the health department meet, is what they could have done out here was had a series right now of five different 2-inch lines, because 10 inch is not what they need to serve right now. Five different 2-inch lines, would have had virtually no setback. But they decided to look forward to the future and do a 10 inch here. And so I think the conclusion was that why should this land developer have to be penalized for providing capacity for a big chunk of the Stevens Creek Basin? And Black Hills felt like it was better to have one line rather than five in terms of it getting hit by construction activity. So with that said, we appreciate the health department working with us on that, and the 109 feet versus the 154 feet lends a lot more area to do some things. More than likely it'll be in the multifamily area, it'll be parking and garages. In the future B2 area, it'll be parking. And so, and then the line juts across O Street, so we were able to do the townhomes on the east side. So There is still, I think, a reasonable setback distance there. So otherwise, this development is a good contiguous use of the expansion of the Stevens Creek Trunk Sewer. It's now getting up to this point. New water line going in O Street. And it'll be a nice mix of multifamily, commercial, townhome, and single family. And I think we've tried to work well on those connectivity issues as much as we could with the Hillcrest neighbors to the east and without having to buy some of their homes and make that road connection. So anyway, I apologize for my tardiness and thank the both planning and health for working on us and be happy to answer any questions.
Carl.
Okay, thank you. Mike, I'm curious about O Street.
Mm-hmm.
Did you have any conversations with the Department of Roads about their plans to expand O Street and widen that?
Well, we did, Commissioner Estridge, and I'll put this up. The location that we have our access point going up is really in line with the access management policy that was passed a few years ago. So you've got 84th and 98th, and so that's your mile. Mm-hmm. And then, so we've got ours here, which is a little bit past quarter for that access point. And what NDOR does have planned, and it did factor into this use permit that was recently approved for an elderly care facility, is that this drive going into Hillcrest Golf Course and Anthony Lane going into the Hillcrest Residential will be combined into one. And so between 84th and 98th, we'll have what Public Works would desire in terms of 1, 2, 3, 4 access points. Okay. And so we tied in with that plan and we're continuing to work with them. This was restricted access. We're going through the appraisal process and the design process for the turn lanes there. But there is some foresight to maybe to answer your question on how this mile will work, given that it is already a state highway and we'll get more urban traffic. So. Right.
Okay, thank you.
Larry?
Thanks for being here, Mike. And before you came in, what I did say was that with the exceptions and sort of changes to this site and the connectivity issues, it's not that any one of them can't be worked with. It's just that the combination of them raised some issues of, you know, safety.
Sure.
You mentioned that Black Hills has built this pipeline to be, they overbuilt it.
Mm-hmm.
Are you saying that they have no plans, that they have no intention of ever building out to the maximum pressure?
In the meeting we had with their council and their operation manager for this area, they did say that in the near and distant future, they don't think that they're going to have to increase it. And they explained also, which I was unfamiliar with, the standards they have to go through at the federal level to do that. But
The difference in distance was maybe 50 feet or something. How many of the potential homes that you hope to put here would actually fall in that that beyond, you know, up to the 154, how many of them are, if you were observing that standard for the maximum pressure, how many homes would actually be in that
the
area?
Multifamily area, I'll put this up for you, Larry. The areas in orange are the multifamily areas, and we have done some hypothetical layouts. And we think there's probably a density of about 200 units here. But in all of our layouts, we've got the garages and access drives up here. And so in the area, let's say between the 109 and the 154, I think you're looking at the tail end of some of the buildings. I mean, my guess would be if we were to build that today, you'd have maybe about 6 to 12 units of each building that would be in within that difference of distance.
Okay.
So.
Other questions? All right. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Anyone else wishing to speak to this item? Okay, next item, please.
Next, I'll call items 22 through 25. They are approving a cable television franchise agreement for a 15-year term with Allo Communications to provide cable television services and products to the citizens of Lincoln. Approving a broadband franchise agreement for a 25-year term with Allo Communications. Approving a conduit lease agreement for a 25-year term with Allo Communications to occupy space in the city's Lincoln Technology Improvement District conduit system, and amending Title V of the Lincoln Municipal Code relating to licenses and regulations to create a new Chapter 5.12 entitled Residential Broadband to coordinate the regulations with the newly negotiated broadband franchise.
Good afternoon, Steve Huggenberger from City Law Department. We're going to tag team on these four things. The first one up, the cable television franchise. This is essentially an identical franchise to the Windstream franchise that you reviewed and approved late last year. I'll just point out what the details are, but they are identical. It's a 15-year agreement. There are probably three different items that are not identical. And the next one is one of those items that's not identical. The construction is expected to be complete within 4 years with service to all residents. That's different than the Windstream agreement. The franchise fee is the same as Windstream and Time Warner Cable, 5% of gross revenues. Customer service standards are identical to the other two providers. They're the federal customer service standards. The complaint reporting, this is another item that's different. The complaint reporting will be on all complaints, not just written complaints. Free service to government buildings, the same as the other two providers. Public education and government access programming is provided for. The PEG fees are identical here as the other two providers, which is 41 cents per sub per month. There is a fiber grant requirement in this franchise, which is identical to Windstream's fiber grant requirement. And I would add that the cable television Telecommunication Advisory Board recommended unanimous approval with those that were present. I think there was only one person not there, Mr. Feller. But.
Two committees at one time.
Unless there are questions, that's all I have on the cable television franchise agreement.
Questions for Steve? Larianne.
You mentioned three ways it's different from the Windstream agreement, and I think you mentioned construction complete within 4 years to every home is one of them. Complaint reporting on all complaints is the second one. What was the third? Is it, does it have to do with a lower price tier of service? Or I guess I'm wondering if you had a third that you wanted to share.
I think there was a third, and I'm not remembering what it was.
I thought you said it received unanimous approval by the cable board, and I don't know if the Time Warner Cable one received unanimous approval.
I think she was talking about connection to Windstream, which we previously approved with the last council.
That wasn't a difference.
Okay.
David is helping me out here. The grantee shall not require residential contracts for service. That was a difference as well.
Okay. All right. Questions for Mr. Huggenberger? Cindy.
So when we talk about the franchisee not requiring contracts for residential service, you're talking about durational contracting?
Yes. You don't sign up for 2 years.
Okay. So they'll be able to be on a month-to-month basis, the residents that sign up for
that. That is my understanding. And I know Mr. Moline is here. If he understands that differently, he will tell you.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Other questions? All right. Thank you. David?
Councilors, thank you for allowing me to speak today. I'll be speaking about the conduit lease agreement and the fiber, the broadband franchise. See if we can get the technology to work here. About 10 slides to cover, maybe. You know, I've said this
only
so many
faster
times.
Speed.
I don't need
slides.
We got it. Yeah, there we go. All right. Conduit lease agreement. Same as the other ones, three differences. 25 years, our existing conduit lease agreements are 10 years or 15 years or 20 years. It all depends on what the company was looking for. This is a 25-year conduit lease agreement. The fee paid for the conduit lease agreement is $3 per subscriber per month, as opposed to a flat fee with our other conduit agreements. And the requirement for a broadband franchise is enshrined in the conduit lease agreement. Those are the three differences. Other than that, they're the same document. The broadband franchise is a new document for Lincoln. It describes broadband service. Basically, we started on August 11th. Here we are December 7th, 4 months later, asking for your review and approval of a contract to build fiber to every home in Lincoln. This will be available to businesses and residents throughout the city. And ALLO has agreed to lease the last space in the system, and we asked for the broadband franchise in return for that. Broadband service is defined in the franchise as 100 megabits per second or faster. There is a floor, the concept of you will provide at least 100 megabits of service. What is 100 megabits of service, really? The ability to stream 5 HD movies at the same time, check your email, and surf the web. You know, I'm not watching that many shows at home, but that's what 100 megabits will do for you. The term of this deal is 25 years. We define broadband further by including all network neutrality provisions, no blocking of content, no throttling of content, no paid prioritization, and no data caps. It's very important that we have these part of our proposal to describe what is the way service will be provided to the end user on this next generation infrastructure. Every resident, first 4 years, that's a lot of construction to happen. I believe that some of you will probably receive phone calls about that construction. It's an aggressive time schedule, yes, but we want to get it done. We want to make it available. Non-discriminatory rates and terms. Everybody pays the same price. That's important. No more negotiating. No residential service contracts. No installation fees. No modem fees. Ask for service, get service. It's a novel concept. 100 government buildings will get 1 gigabit of service for no charge. 50 government buildings will get 10 gigabits of service. Yeah, we'll probably have the first 50 right off the bat, 10 gigabits of service. All public buildings will be upgraded to 10 gig before the end of the term. 15 public VLANs, we've talked about this individually, what those are used for. 500 traffic signals. Most importantly, the replacement electronics necessary for all of this infrastructure will be replaced as needed. Community services. We have 75 qualifying nonprofit organizations will get 1 gigabit of service for 10 years as part of this program. There's a low cost service tier. 20 megabit broadband will be available to anyone in the city for $45 a month. On top of that, if you are eligible for the FCC Lifeline program, you will get a 15% discount guaranteed. And the city may opt in to an additional 15% discount paid for out of franchise fees. So we would create a program and work with the council to decide how we administer that program. This will be a new initiative. Basically, this would drive the price down to about $20, $22 a month for 20 megabits of service up and down. It's a very good program. City Wi-Fi service, 2006. Many of the counselors who were on this council today, some of which I know Councilor Camp was on this, looked at City of Wi-Fi. And what did they say? They said, not for the whole city, but downtown. We should do that. A month after the council came out with their recommendations, the iPhone 1 was announced. So now we are going to get that. Three areas will be provided by ALLO at no charge. And those will be constructed at 18, 36, and 54 months. And we'll work together to decide where we're going to construct those. LES has agreed to create a dark fiber lease agreement and work with the PSC to make that agreement available not just to ALLO, but to any other carrier in the community for their excess fiber. And they've also agreed to create an expedited pole attachment permit process to speed up the construction. Those are our inputs into the public benefit program. New services will be created without raising taxes or requiring a bond. We're not paying for this infrastructure. Private investment is paying for this infrastructure. It's very important. The lease agreement recovers the city's inspection and maintenance costs and ultimately will create new revenue for the city. Not today. It'll take a little bit of time, but we will recover our cost. That last slide wasn't important. Allo's investment in the community will be over $100 million. That's jobs. That's investment. That's economic activity in our community over the next 4 years. Several communities have gigabit internet, are building gigabit internet. They say 1.1% growth in economic activity. That's $100 million of new economic activity in Lincoln. Basically the same amount. So it's a $200 million investment right off the bat. Home values will increase. The system will provide education opportunities that are not available to us right now. How did we gain such favorable terms? We had a great partner on the other side of the table. This was a collaborative effort that took us 90 days. Demands were not made, questions were asked, and solutions were proposed. This was not a one-sided negotiation. It was more of a conversation about how to build the next generation infrastructure in Lincoln quickly, affordably, and to provide the service characteristics that we want to see on this infrastructure.
Questions for David? Are you?
I will talk for another hour.
I know you will.
You guys know me. Now I will
talk. We've met, so. Yes. questions for David. Cindy.
Yes, I just want to clarify for the citizens of Lincoln. You had indicated that the replacement or maintenance of the conduit would be taken care of immediately, and that will fall, responsibility for that will fall to Allo, is that correct?
To clarify, I said replacement electronics to run the fiber optics at all the government facilities and traffic signals will be provided by Allo. The city's responsibility is the conduit. Arguably, we are one of the best in the state at building conduit and pipe infrastructure. We do it very well. So we put the conduit in, we manage the conduit, we maintain the conduit. We do that as part of street widening projects now, and we have since 1979. That's how we ended up with 300 miles to start with. Allo will extend the conduit system, most likely another 100 miles as part of this project. All extensions in the public right-of-way will be owned by the city. But the maintenance cost is on the city for that infrastructure. And that's why we charge the lease fees that we do to the other entities as well as to Allo.
Other questions? Carl.
Thank you. David, you indicated that there will be an expedited permit process with LES to gain access to their poles where that's necessary. Security's important everywhere these days, but particularly with LES, they're concerned about security of their systems. Can you talk a little bit about protecting their security here?
The security that LES is concerned about is in the fiber leasing, making sure that cyber attacks are not able to attack their substation, their infrastructure. The way we would ensure and work with LES to ensure their security is made whole is records will be retained by LES. Allo will access them on site locally, and that dark fiber will be what is leased, not lit fiber. So literally you can think about it as separate cables. Okay. And unless you figure out how to get light to transfer from one cable to another without connecting them, I think we're pretty secure. The expedited pole attachment process is really a business-friendly process that we're creating. Right now it can take 90 days to get a permit. Wow. To attach to a pole. But there's a lot of reasons why. There's a lot of engineering that goes into validating whether a pole can be attached to or not. What we're working with LES to create, and LES is the driver behind this, is a process that dramatically shrinks that. And they're adopting some of the research that was done in Kansas City and a few other communities for this expedited process.
Okay, thank you.
Larry.
You mentioned that the conduit will be built out another 100 miles at least, and it's easy to imagine the streets being torn up, but can you speak to what the damage really will be and what kind of liability the city might incur during that process? I understand you're going to be doing some core work, not necessarily tearing up the streets. Well, is that right?
That's correct. The goal is to, and has been for a long time, when we were building conduit, to build it basically behind the sidewalk, at the property line, the right-of-way line, or between the sidewalk and the curb when possible. We will do directional boring. You've seen, you dig the pits and then you do the run the stem in the ground and pull the pipe in to avoid road cuts at all possible ways. With that said, in order to do directional boring correctly, you have to pothole utilities, basically drilling a hole in the pavement and visually locating the utilities so you can verify the depth. We are doing two things. One, we're going to adopt a new potholing standard for repair of those potholes. And two, we are co-locating all of the locators that currently work in the city into a single group who manages locates so we can be responsive to the request. The liability for the city is in the locates. We are required within 72 hours of a company making a locate request to physically locate our water, sewer, and stormwater lines and our conduit. If we do not do that, and any private company, Black Hills, LES, the sewer department, if we don't locate our water line and somebody hits that water line, we are responsible or liable for the repair cost. So that is our liability. By using good construction management techniques and kind of redesigning our department a little bit to handle this influx of locates, that's how we're going to handle it.
Love to hear more about what the potholing standard, what you meant by that. But before we get to that, you've touched on a public responsibility. This is a massive private investment that's being made, and we're lucky to have that kind of partnership, public-private partnership. What is the extent of the public responsibility for this project to succeed beyond boring these holes?
The public will invest roughly $550,000 a year for the first 4 years. That cost is four positions, two inspectors and two locators. At the end of the 4 years, the two inspection positions will be absorbed into public works through retirements, and the two locators will continue on.
Again, because that's locating utilities and making sure we address our liability concerns.
Okay. Yes. Okay. That is our investment in this project.
And the potholing standards, what's that about?
Well, Thomas and I have a lot to discuss on the potholing standard. We've been talking about this for about a year now. So there are pavement indexes that say some version of this. If a pavement is less than 5 years old and you do more than two core holes in a single panel, you must replace that panel. If the pavement is 5 to 10 years old, you would epoxy back in the original core. So if you're drilling through it, you epoxy it back in. And if it's from 10 to 15 years old, you would replace it with basically a concrete slurry mixture in the core of the pavement. What we'd like to do is look at that and how it affects the city. We've done a lot of construction recently, as many of you know. We want to protect that investment. But we are required by law to pothole those facilities. And so we need to balance what is good governance, what is a good construction standard. What we don't want is a string of potholes every 6 inches going across a brand new street, right? So working together to define that, we will define that in the next couple of months. We basically have until March to get that figured out, so.
Great. Other questions? You still going? Cindy.
Thank you. When I go back to the four positions that you were talking about, that would require then initially four brand new positions?
Correct.
Okay, and then you had mentioned two would remain, and then what would happen to the other two employees?
They would be absorbed by retirements. Basically, as inspectors retire in the right-of-way department or in design and construction, we would absorb those positions, and at 4 years, basically come back to the same level we have in inspectors. But we do need more locators.
John.
All of these positions would be paid for by the enterprise fund that we're setting up, which would be the funds from the existing conduit leases and from this conduit lease as well.
John?
Yeah, two questions, please, Mr. Young. First, on those locator positions, I believe in a previous briefing you said something like $185,000 a year for those four. Am I recalling that correctly?
I believe roughly that's the salary cost of those positions, $250,000 of maintenance for the conduit for the first 4 years, and then there's a little bit of capital expense, overhead.
Do you think that $185 for the position is a little bit low when you take into account benefits and so forth?
We have.
Because you're talking about $40,000, $45,000 a person, and I know our health costs can be $15,000 to $20,000 a person.
If you can excuse me, I'll grab my document right quick. And
right
You may have seen this.
Yeah. Just want to make sure we're
projecting
this correctly, because there are some hidden costs or extra costs at times.
We expect the construction inspectors to be at $90,000 per inspector loaded labor rate, and the locators to be at $75,000 per loaded labor rate. Fuel, vehicle overhead, and the vehicle replacement program, $50,000 for administrative overhead, brings us to $580,000 of investment the first 4 years, roughly.
So my 185, I must have misrecorded that.
I think that was when you, after year four, you will go down to $75,000 per for two locators, and then fuel, vehicle replacement, overhead, personal equipment, safety equipment. Okay. I think that's the $187,000.
Okay, thank you for clarifying that. My second question is, if you would address the fact you mentioned that there are three different scenarios you have projected there, that starting at roughly $500,000 a year, the first 4 years that the city would be investing in this. Could you explain the interloan or interfund loans that you're proposing? Or maybe, I guess we don't have Mr. Hubka here, but if you could discuss that, please.
I am not an accountant. I will build your network and happily discuss that with you. The intricacies of interfund borrowing, basically we're going to set up an account. My understanding is take a loan from the risk fund, because that's really what we're doing is risk mitigation. And then that fund will be paid back through conduit leases and the lease from this program over a period of 4 to 8 years, depending on which projection you see that actually comes true. They are projections.
Yeah. In other words, we're borrowing from other city reserves to do this, and we're paying our self-interest, but we do have that interfund. And then I believe, too, that this will all be set up under an enterprise fund.
Correct.
So we can control revenues versus expenses.
The example that I was
not
given.
Control, but identify.
Identify, yes, and segment. The example I was given was it's like the purchasing of the ambulance for the fire department and setting up that business unit. So it would be very similar to that.
Other questions for David? Lirian.
I will talk for hours. You guys know me.
The Wi-Fi, the public Wi-Fi, or the outdoor Wi-Fi locations. I know you'll be working with ALLO to identify what locations. Do you have any initial thoughts on how you'll determine those locations or what factors will be important to consider?
Population density is going to be very important. Where are we going to get our most bang for our dollar? We don't want to put access points where we have two people. I think that the initial discussion will surround some version of this, O Street to Q Street, Antelope Valley to Canopy Drive. Basically covering the economic areas of downtown and our new arts and entertainment district, Haymarket and Rail Yard.
Would that be considered one location? That whole
to me it would, but it's a negotiation, I believe.
how large could one of these hot spots or these be?
We don't define that. We talk in terms of jointly defining it. It's very hard today to talk about, you know, it will be this specifically when our first deployment won't happen for 18 months. Right now you see 802.11 AC is the new standard, and how much coverage that can handle, 300-foot circle, 300 customers, no problem. But in 18 months, AF may be out. And so we want to be able to design it fluidly.
Other questions? Go ahead.
I guess just we have an estimated four-year timeline for the fiber to the home piece. If for some reason that timeline wasn't being met, what do the agreements say about that?
There are probably two pages worth of termination clause language in these agreements, and while we would not want to enforce those, we have the right to terminate the agreement for non-performance. We own all the conduit that's installed in the ground. Upon termination, the company would be required to A, pull the fiber out, or B, we own the fiber. Given the opportunity, I would love to own the fiber. My best guess is they're going to be pretty successful.
Okay. And to end on a positive note, as you look at this deal, what would you say is the most exciting piece of this for the residents of Lincoln?
We're building a brand new infrastructure, and it's being funded with private dollars and private investment. And it took us 90 days to come to an agreement. I think that shows exactly what you want from your representatives in government, which is flexibility and speed to build the infrastructure that we need. We are in the infrastructure business. I mean, that is our core business. And so making this investment possible by leveraging existing assets and creative minds is important. And that excites me to see our the agility of our team, which includes you.
All right. Thank you very much. All right. Anyone else wishing to speak? I see somebody getting up.
Good afternoon. Brad Moline, President of Allo Communications. First of all, the council members, thank you for letting me present today. Allo Communications has been in the fiber business since 2003, 2004, operating in western Nebraska, and we've expanded over that time. So we have a significant track record of doing this type of project, but this would be our largest project. We're focused on delivering the best technology available to both businesses and residents in the communities that we serve. We also have a desire, and I think you could tell by David's comments, that we aren't a niche player. We want to cover the entire city because we believe that changes the ecosystem of the city, government, education, healthcare, and things we haven't even thought about that will occur in the future. So that's very important to us. Currently, we've done this in six communities, and the most important thing that I like to point out is we're a competitive company. We bring another choice to the residents and businesses and governmental entities within your community. And we compete very hard for our share of the market share, but our competitors do as well. And the result is everybody is better, and prices generally become a little less expensive for the community. That's a part of the economic development that's really hard to track, but it's very important. As we do this, Allo was founded about 12 years ago with about four main values. One is to be exceptional in everything we do. Another is to be hassle-free, work with the customers to make it easy, the governmental entities and everyone to be easy to deal with. Another is to be honest, and the last one's to be local. And that means employing a lot of jobs here. We'll employ hundreds of jobs in the city of Lincoln. Big initiatives like this take a group. This is phenomenal how fast this has come together. And I commend the city of Lincoln, your representatives that you employ. Also, our new partners, Nelnet, provided the financial well-being, and we come as an experienced telecommunications provider. Those three things coming together and the fact that we're standing here this fast is amazing. I've been working with another community on the Front Range of Colorado for 3.5 years, and we really haven't got started. It's still in the early stages of contemplating how to do it. So everyone should be commended, and it really takes a group to do this. Currently, we're working with local people, and we'll work with a lot of engineers, or we'll work with a lot of people, including the engineering company. We've selected Olson Associates to work with, but we'll have a lot of contractors, be bringing in a lot of construction employees, have a lot of permanent employees, both on the CSRs, technicians and leadership of the company will be working here. So it's going to be a pretty exciting time. Once completed, we believe that Lincoln will have a fiber infrastructure that will really be something that the community can be proud of. I know we have very exacting standards internally, and we'll make sure that happens. So I encourage you to support this project. And with that, I'll open it to questions.
Questions for Brad? Larry.
So as you look to scale up the work that you've already done in western Nebraska, how do you foresee managing this growth? What challenges do you see as you take on this project? And is that 4-year time frame, are you feeling comfortable about that?
Yes. it's interesting in our industry. We use a technique called GPON, and what you do is you take any size community and you make it a group of subset of construction, and those can either be in 500 entity or 1,000 entity units. And so the interesting thing is, even in a 25,000 person community, let's say North Platte, Nebraska, that we've already done, it really decomposes into those sizes. There's 10,000 of those. There were 10 of those units. There's going to be about 87 to 100 of those units in Lincoln. We'll attack them. We'll bring in multiple crews that will be approved by the city, and we have a target to beat that 4-year time frame, but we won't beat it by much. It's a very aggressive time frame. I will point out that we'll enter virtually every backyard and virtually every outside every business in the city. So it will move very fast, but it will be a little bit disruptive.
Are there parts of this project that are new for you, your company?
I don't think so. The new areas are some of the agreements. They have a little different style, pulling fiber through conduit that we don't own. We pull fiber through conduit all the time, but working with the city, that'll be something new. But in general, everything else is proven. There will be incremental changes that our industry is moving very rapidly. So will the same construction methods that we implement as soon as the ground thaws in February or late February, early March, will they be the same that we finish with 4 years from now or 3 years from now? Probably not. There'll be some incremental improvements.
And how will you tackle the geographical rollout of this project, given that you're looking at providing access citywide? Can you help us understand what that rollout will look like?
Do you mean, well, where is it going to be first? Where is it going to be last? Those types of things. It's largely,
I'm citywide, but some of these people are district reps, and I think they're probably curious.
Yes. that's the number one question we have, is who's first, who's last? And it's really controlled much more by engineering. Engineering makes about 85% of the decisions. One neighborhood to another that are side by side, if we have some pre-sales, we might go right before we go left. But that's not going to be a material decision. The important thing to note is that in that 4-year time frame, everybody will be covered. And so if it was a 15-year time frame, the first and last may mean something. Unfortunately, in our business, managing the people who are last, someone has to be last. It's usually people on the outskirts of town that are a little harder to get to, and that becomes hard to work with. But the common question is, will it be certain socioeconomic situations or that? And it really isn't. In this industry, your take rates are pretty much the same across the board. The closer homes that are together, the more profitable it is for us. In the more estate sections, we're actually less profitable. And so if we were making decisions based off of profit, it would probably be counterintuitive. But if it was, but we're going after the entire city, we'll let engineering make most of the calls.
Well, and I'm glad you brought up affordability, because that's a part of access, right? If you're trying to provide access to more people. In previous franchise agreements for cable, we've had this issue come up of affordability for residents. Can you speak to how this deal and your company's plans for having lower tier pricing options?
Basically, we have what we define as broadband, the 100 meg or gigabit today. And then we also have an economy tier that we'll subsidize. And it's 20 meg by 20 meg, so it's not slow. It's actually an incredibly fast service. And the current rate on that is $45 per month. We don't anticipate changing that price when we launch. We will subsidize for those people, the easiest way to say it, who qualify for the state and federal lifeline program, will subsidize 15%, and the city has the option of subsidizing another 15%. So there could be 30% off of that rate for low income. That's an incredible amount of bandwidth. That isn't like many others have done, where they'll do a very low price for 5 meg down, 1 meg up, which is really, you can answer your email. This is 20 by 20 service. It'll be very good. We really hope that helps education and those types of things. My overall goal is for the federal and state regulatory bodies to then become providing that lifeline availability through the federal and state programs. And so we may be able to step back from those commitments as businesses and, or as our business and as the city, or maybe add that on to the federal program as well. The momentum is headed that way, and we'll be working with the Public Service Commission to make sure that we work together on that.
We've talked about how this will benefit residents, or you've talked about the benefits for residences, but can you speak to the benefits for Lincoln businesses?
Yes, the largest businesses today in Lincoln have access to fiber through a variety of companies that a lot of times we interconnect with, and sometimes we're competitors with. We all work together. But the small to mid-sized business, there's a gap there today, in our opinion. That's the four-person business, the community gas station, those types, small law firm, those types of businesses. Again, we're not a niche player. Every entity that our fiber passes is a potential customer for us, and we have products to serve all of those.
Thank you.
Other questions? John.
Thank you, Mr. Mullane. Appreciate all of your efforts in this. I just did a calculation. 4 years at 365 days a year is 1,460 days you're going to be done.
actually, I wish your calculations were correct.
Well, I guess
correct.
There's leap year in there, 1,461 days.
Well, and I'm gonna make it a little harder on myself. Don't forget, we live in a four-season-of-the-year community. We can only construct in three of those seasons. So it's, we'll...
So 1,132 days?
Exactly.
When does that start?
As soon as the ground thaws. As soon as fiber, when it's really cold, becomes difficult to work with. It's not impossible. In some cases, it's not as bad as some of the other modes of communication, but it's most efficient to work when it's a little warmer. But after that first build cycle, our construction methods, we'll be able to do installations and in building work and that type of thing year round. It's just the heavy boring and things like that. Some of the construction techniques require water, and when it's freezing out, we become less than popular if we're leaving a lot of ice and things like that around. So we try to be very good citizens.
Going to my serious question, you've talked about inconveniences to property owners and so forth, and I think perhaps, so we don't have a lot of people really worried, could you address which are some of the approaches, whether you're going to be burying cable versus hanging it off of power lines that we currently have, and then also the coordination with the Lincoln Electric Systems program of continually burying more power lines?
We use some very kind of state-of-the-art, I guess best way to say it, design for it to find the most cost-efficient, longest-lasting, and when you say cost-efficient, that doesn't mean just in the construction stage. It's also in how we maintain the plant. And so we'll determine, and it'll probably be 90-10, 80-20, 90% underground, 10% aerial, 80% underground, 20% aerial, somewhere in there is my expectation. We'll determine those paths, get the documents to the city for permitting, as well as LES and others, to make sure everybody knows what is our 2016 construction plan as soon as possible. Let people go through that and make sure everybody's nodding their head and saying, yes, it makes sense. Then the construction techniques we use are proven. They've many in the industry, some with some very large names, use that, and as well as some people like us. And these are we try to be as minimally invasive within the rights of way as possible. And so we'll move very rapidly. We'll inform the landowners when we're going to be building an area. And we do a very good job of leaving it as we found it. Again, we're in a competitive business. If we don't do our job, we create enemies, and that doesn't bode well for our company. So we pride ourselves on the quality of our construction. And then as a customer wants our service, we come from the alley or the whatever, wherever the easement is, into the home. And we structure that very well. We schedule appointments that are specific appointments, and generally we hit either right on the time within 15 minutes. If we're going to be much later than that, we call, let people know. Again, all these people have other choices, and we're the second, third, fourth option for them. And for us to get market share, we have to be very good at what we do.
Thank you.
Other questions?
I do have one more.
Lurian.
I wanted to ask about the outdoor Wi-Fi. I mistakenly earlier called it public Wi-Fi. It's not public Wi-Fi, it's outdoor Wi-Fi. Can you speak to how this might work, what the charges or fees may be, and what you think will be important for the criteria for selecting where those Wi-Fi areas are located?
This is an area of the industry that's moving very rapidly. And that's one of the reasons I really liked the idea of, hey, this shouldn't be the first thing we build. Let's build it in three increments throughout the a 4 or 5 year time frame. I think the first within 18 months of passing 50% of the homes. And so this will be in that first year and a half to 3 years. One, the technology is moving very fast. And so I can't tell you what it's going to look like at that time, but how it will work is we'll work with the city, determine an area need, and we'll offer service that provides a certain amount of free time, if you will, for guests, those types of situations. Generally, how these work is then people who are on your service can connect automatically, and those who want it longer then can make a purchasing decision. But the idea is to allow people to move throughout your community in a variety of areas and always have connectivity. And these free Wi-Fi areas end up being, they work with the cell phone companies and others so that you can live, work, and play throughout a larger geographical distance.
Thank you.
Did that answer it?
All right, anything else? All right, thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your time.
Anyone else wishing to speak to these items?
Good afternoon. Good afternoon, Chairman Fellers and members of the council. I'm Wendy Birdsall. I'm the president of the Lincoln Chamber of Commerce. This fiber to home project truly is a game changer for Lincoln. And I want to say a big thank you to Nelnet and Allo Communications. I also want to thank, but let me back up just a second. I want to say a big thanks to Nelnet and Allo, but I also specifically want to say a big thank you to Mike Dunlap, whose vision and commitment to this community is unparalleled. I'd also like to thank Mayor Beitler and the city staff who work to make this a reality. And I'd like to thank each and every one of you for helping move this project forward. The Chamber and the Lincoln Partnership for Economic Development embarked on a process at the beginning of this year to ask the question, what's next for Lincoln? And part of finding that answer, we hired Angelou Economics, who came to conduct a survey and an analysis of our community, who had been here once before. And the Angelou team received unprecedented and cooperation and responses from not just our businesses, to which 400 businesses responded. Also, there were 3,000 respondents from the community. We found that the community of Lincoln are very hungry for technology. And more than anything, they wanted to see Lincoln as a 21st century city. They wanted to see it as a wired community. They wanted to see us as a globally competitive city. Infrastructure is the cornerstone to each of these. A 1 gig service to any business or resident allows companies to transmit data at some of the highest levels available today. Entrepreneurs will be able to work from home without limits to what they can achieve. Students, faculty members at the university and all levels of education will be more connected to the global learning community and will join an elite peer group offering fiber to every home. But even more impressive, and which is what makes me so excited, is that the public and national perception that will come with becoming a gig city. You've heard me say it before, and it's never been more true than today. There's never been a better time to be in Lincoln, Nebraska. Again, I'd like to thank the pioneers who helped make this a reality and contributed to this project. Excuse me. And I would like to ask each and every one of you to support this initiative to help continue Lincoln's momentum forward.
Questions for Whit?
Questions?
Okay. All right. Thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak to these items?
This is my first time testifying, so go easy on me. My name is Scott Rutz. I'm marketing and sales director for Travify. We're based down in the Haymarket, one of the startups down there. But when I found out about this a few months ago, I thought about a couple things. The first thing is connectivity. The second thing is daily friction. And the third thing is the ecosystem. So to really go through that very briefly, in terms of connectivity with Travify, we have anywhere from 25 to 50% of our team working remotely every day. So this is huge, you know, in terms of you just want to have a quick chat about a project with a team member. You'd be surprised how often we can't get the connectivity we need just to be able to talk to each other via video chat or things like that. You know, the second item of daily friction, it's so frequent that when you have so many clusters of companies working on the same connection, it's really hard to actually just transfer documents back and forth and be able to continue with those processes of marketing, of sales, of code, of all those things. It actually holds you back. And then the last thing, probably the most important thing that I think about is the ecosystem that Lincoln somehow created with startups. It's really special and it's really hard to create. And this is a huge asset in terms of competitive nature. If you're recruiting startups in to Lincoln, they have to choose between Omaha, Des Moines, KC, Iowa City, Minneapolis, all of these Midwestern cities that have low cost to build qualities. And this is definitely an area where Lincoln can win in. So that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak, please come down.
Good afternoon, everyone. I apologize for my voice up front. It's the holiday season, all the joy that that brings. Good afternoon. My name is Bradley Walker. I'm a resident at 1800 High Street here in Lincoln, Nebraska, and I'm here to support this franchise agreement. I'll give you a little bit of history lesson. I actually first appeared in front of this group in 2003, so just a little over 12, almost 13 years ago, to talk about digital fiber, and we're still talking about it. At the time, I think Councilman Camp, you were there at those meetings early on, we discussed the importance of digital infrastructure for this community in the future. Had we acted 12 years ago, think of what we could have accomplished and put Lincoln on a map to some of the other points that have been raised. We could have been so much further ahead, but we chose not to take that opportunity. We also had the discussion around the WiMAX and Wi-Fi systems that we could do, thinking about connectivity that could be distributed across the community without having conduits. And again, we chose not to go down that path. I appeared here as well to support the conduit project, which we did do, and that was absolutely outstanding. We said at the time that it would be a catalyst for future infrastructure and growth in Lincoln, and it has been all that and more. And today, it enables the proposal that you see in front of you and the type of public-private partnership that we have a chance to create here in Lincoln. So given that, I think the time is now to have a vastly different level of service. Digital fiber to the home is critically important for a number of different reasons, if I may share. First, my wife and I are both employees of global organizations who do not do business primarily here in Lincoln, Nebraska. There are many other professionals who have the exact same requirement, that is to work and be distributed wherever we are, and hopefully choose Lincoln to call home. As we look at recruiting talent, we're training talent, having that ability for a spouse or a family member or another significant other to be able to work remotely for their global organizations is absolutely outstanding as well. We need to provide that infrastructure for people to be based here and yet be able to participate in the global economy. Further, I will say that that gap that was described earlier between the small to medium-sized businesses and the larger businesses in Lincoln is significant. The startup community here has been tremendous, and being a past startup person myself, have experienced the pain and anguish, if you will, of having to deal with the infrastructure that we have. This, again, could change the game in terms of raising up the bar for our small to medium-sized businesses, facilitating new business creation, and really benefit those who live here and choose to work here. And the last thing I'll say is, given the bullet points that were made about this particular proposal, you have a world-class deal in front of you, truly. I've had a chance to see some other communities. The Google Fiber Project, we submitted an application for many, many years ago. Lincoln wasn't selected as the recipient of that, but I have had a chance to spend time in Kansas City, and it has been a remarkable experience for Kansas City. It does have a buzz, and it does have a certain je ne sais quoi, if you will, for business and startup communities now in our Midwestern area. And so to see that and bring that here is just really an exciting opportunity, I think, for me to see us benefit here in Lincoln and really set ourselves ahead. And where we'll do that is through net neutrality. I can't underscore that provision nearly enough, that not having a content restriction or services that are primarily just made by the internet network provider for the participants, and having an open network that anybody can benefit from, I think is another tremendous asset to this particular proposal. So I'd encourage your support as well. Thank you. Any questions?
Questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you all very much.
Anyone else wishing to speak to these items, please come forward. All right, Mr. Huggenberry, do you have any rebuttal or?
Don't have rebuttal, but we have two more items we haven't talked about yet. Yeah. The clerk called four items. We've only talked about two.
Yep. Would you like to go through and discuss the conduit lease and the
David will talk franchise? About the conduit lease, and I'll talk about Chapter 5.12. The fourth thing that we're doing with these items today is we're proposing creating another chapter, Chapter 5.12, which would be broadband franchising. And what we're doing is putting in place a regulatory framework for franchising broadband services. And we're talking about a broadband franchise being required for every entity which meets two requirements. One, they have to be using the city's conduit system. And two, they have to be providing broadband service to the residential population of the city. And that's why neither Windstream nor Time Warner will be required to get a broadband franchise. They're not using the city's conduit system. They're using their own facilities. This is a very similar regulatory framework that was created and put in place for franchising cable television services. And to just summarize the process, you would file an application, you would describe what your proposal is, you'd describe the route, the construction process, the location of your facilities, whatever technical requirements would be with your system. There would be filing fees. There would be a maximum term of 25 years. And as I described this, this is the franchise that we have with ALLO. The requirements that I'm talking about is what we have with ALLO. There'd be requirements in insurance, termination, foreclosure, transfers, reporting, access to records, service characteristics, services to government buildings, and of course it would require council approval. And we're creating one additional thing. We're having the revenues go into an enterprise fund, which is essentially going back into the system until council decides otherwise. That's all I have on that.
Questions for Steve? Cindy?
So, and I know you said this fits with what the agreement that the city has with ALLO. So this would be then applying to anyone that wanted to come in and build out their own network. Is that right?
So build out their own network using the city's conduit system.
Okay, so anyone that was anyone who wanted to put in their own conduit system.
Any telecommunication provider now can come and ask for permission to put in their own system in the right of way. And what we're saying is you can do that. Federal law allows that. If you want to have speed to market and you want to use our conduit system to do that, we're going to have extra requirements.
Okay. John.
If I may, Mr. Huggenberger, following up on that, our conduit's full now with ALLO. if I understand correctly.
The current conduit is full in some places.
Okay. So we've already got users in there. Will this retroactively, will those users agree to this broadband residential, well, the new?
Well, currently there are no other.
Residential.
Yes, there are no other users of the conduit system that are providing residential service or that I know of that intend to. They may lease to someone that wants to do that. They will be required to comply with this if they choose to serve residential customers.
So this is strictly residential?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Larry? So there's no other broadband franchise agreement in Nebraska, and there are only 10 in the country. Can you talk about how you developed this one? Maybe David wants to chime in. Just what, you know, how did you go about creating something that is really new for us?
Well, we looked at the 10 that we knew of, and then we thought, what's lacking in these 10? And we came up with our own additions to that broadband franchise concept.
Can you share with us how this is different than those other 10 and how it's better?
Why don't you come and talk about VLANs? Now, you've opened Pandora's box by asking him to talk, so.
Some of the major differences, making sure we enshrine network neutrality for the life of the agreement.
I'm sorry, can you move the microphone a little bit closer to you? I know you're tall, but we can't hear you that well.
I'm a little tall, I guess. Is that better?
Yeah.
The major differences, enshrining network neutrality for the entire life of the agreement. Some of the other franchises have it for 3 years, 5 years. Public VLANs, basically virtual networks across the physical network infrastructure. There are 15 of them guaranteed in this franchise. I have seen that nowhere else. Traffic signals, having the traffic signals connected, that I have not seen anywhere else. This allows, as many of you will see, and we've talked about a little bit, a traffic master plan to move forward, how we're going to upgrade the traffic system in the city. And then the construction standards that are in the broadband franchise basically cite the conduit lease agreement. Those are not enshrined in any of the agreements I've seen so far.
Other questions?
I guess I'm just curious with the traffic signals piece, what will that save money for the city then as we look at updating and going more automated with traffic signals? What's the benefit?
The conduit system was originally designed in the 70s and 80s to connect our traffic signals. That's what the original intent of the conduit was. Roughly some number, and I don't have the exact number in front of me, 130 traffic signals now are connected with fiber, and 300 are connected with copper communications. We'll be pulling that copper communications out and upgrading to fiber that's provided by Allo. And so we will not have to pay for those connections where Allo immediately passes the traffic signal to be connected. We will have to pay the one-time connection cost to tie that signal in. This saves us a significant amount of money. More importantly, what would normally be a 30-year plan for us to upgrade an infrastructure will be available to us in the next 4.
And does that upgrade in infrastructure, will I notice it if I'm driving down the streets? Is it something that folks will be able to feel?
I will allow.
Okay, I think you're asking a fiber guy too many traffic questions, so awesome. I'm going to jump up here.
Thanks for being here.
Thomas Schaefer, once again, Interim Director of Public Works and Utilities. Yes, you are going to notice this. What is going to happen is, and if Lonnie was talking to the Angelou group the other day about this, was we have several, we have about 50 detectors at each signal in the ground and in other places. And if one of those goes down, we may not know about it with the copper system. With the system of this fiber, we'll be able to tell more instantaneously of when these detections are down so we can go and make a repair. So if you are on a place and there are several of them where the detection's not working, you're sitting for a long time.
That time
side.
I called Randy Hoskins from my cell phone when
yes.
I was sitting in Antelope
yes.
Valley for seven
so,
minutes. Okay.
Guess
yeah.
what? You will, right. When we have those detections, we can get out and fix them a lot quicker. You'll notice it. We can tie signals together. We can start to see platooning measures and run traffic through corridors a lot more better because we can communicate much quicker with this fiber. So you'll notice that if you're in the middle of a peak hour or some sort, even if you're not in the peak hour, you'll be able to notice that.
So when we were looking at that grant for automated signal technology on 27th, North 27th, it was expensive, and we were working with the federal government to pay for that, correct?
Correct.
Will this then mean that we can do it locally without that kind of assistance and it will be cheaper? Is that what we're talking about?
It'll help put a lot of those efforts into place. It won't put everything into place, but it'll put a lot of the, as David pointed out, a lot of the backbone in that we need.
So it'll make our streets smarter?
Yes.
Nice. Thanks.
Other questions? All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you for stepping in. I would have said something like, we can make all the lights turn green.
So that's what I heard. All right. Anyone that wants to speak about the two items that we just talked about? Anybody that wants to come forward? All right. We'll move on to the next item, please.
All right. Next would be our public hearing, ordinance third reading, item 26, amending chapter 2.06 of the Lincoln Municipal Code relating to the mayor's authority to execute contracts by adding a new section, number 2.06.120, requiring council approval of non-bid contracts above $50,000.
I'm going to recognize John to talk about this proposal.
Well, this is a measure that I've been working on, and before my colleagues today, I've got an amendment or a substitute measure, and what I'm going to do today, we've advertised it for public hearing, and we're going to have final action today. I'm going to ask my colleagues to delay 1 week and keep the public hearing open, and then we'll have the decision next week. But the public is encouraged online, and we've got a substitute measure, and I did listen to a number of sources, including my colleagues, the administration, and some architectural and engineering groups, and basically it codifies what had been an executive order and makes a number of changes. But I think with everyone's input, it's dramatically improved over my initial attempt. But there are just a few concerns on some individuals that we're going to address here in the next couple of days. Probably a few I's that need to be dotted and T's crossed and all, but anyone who's been here since this was advertised, they can sure weigh in today. I'll just ask for a motion to a move that we delay with public hearing 1 week and final action next week.
Second.
Okay, I'll take it seconded by Roy, but before we vote, let's have people that want to testify on this item please come forward and tell us what they think. Come on down. Was it something we said?
Good afternoon. I'm Jackie McCullough. I'm with the American Council of Engineering Companies. We're at 1301 South 14th Street. Thank you again for the opportunity to appear before you today. I really appreciate the council listening to our members' concerns and our association's concerns and really taking them to heart and helping craft something that hopefully will get us a little bit closer together on some of these things. And Councilman Camp has been really gracious in visiting with us and spending some time with us. Codifying the current EO is a very positive change. Increasing the reporting mechanisms is a good positive change. Adding a council member to the selection process is a really good change. And I think they all help move forward with Councilman Camp's initial objectives that he had when he brought this to us a few weeks ago. We do have a few concerns that still remain. Just a couple of them that I'd like to share with you today. One of the biggest changes from the current EO to the proposal that is before you today and the amendment is changing the thresholds for the procurement methods, and it would change the procurement method that would require a written proposal. It would drop from $100,000 to $50,000. And I think, as I've mentioned before in my testimony, the price of doing business has increased, and for us to go backwards from $100,000 to $50,000 and asking people to provide proposals seemed a little counterintuitive to me. The other thing I wanted to share with you, you know, we've talked about proposals and how much they might cost to bring those forward. What I did, I asked my member firms to give me some examples. So I want to show you, I can't leave these with you because they're proprietary, but I can show them to you. We've redacted a lot of things. If you want to take a look at them while we're here today, I'll just take them back with me. But I want to show you just a couple of them. This one is on a pavement repair project, which was between the $100,000 and $250,000 process or procurement process. It's 20 pages long. You know, it takes a bit of staff time, both on the private side to put this proposal together and on the public side to review all of these proposals. So when we talk about a written proposal, it's not just a simple thing to put together. This trail renovation project, 31 pages long. A streetscape project is 10 pages long. Those were all in the $100,000 to $250,000 range. This one was in the $250,000 and above range, which is a full proposal and interview process. This one's 55 pages long. So you can see that it takes quite a bit of time and materials, staff time to put those things together. So by dropping it from $100,000 to $50,000, you're really increasing the cost of doing business with the City of Lincoln. And as we've talked before, we've been working really hard to remove barriers and to make the processes move more quickly for the city. I also think that requiring a written proposal for smaller firms and smaller organizations will be an obstacle for them because they don't have, they may or may not have a marketing staff. They may or may not have someone that is able to put together a 10 to 30 page proposal and compete with firms that do. At the current level at $100,000, a department head can call a small firm or any firm on the pre-qual list, doesn't matter their size, and offer them the job if they are pre-qualified and think that they can handle the job and the project. So I think that's a lot easier for smaller firms to be able to compete than it is to have them do these proposals. So just throw that out for your consideration. And again, if you just take the word written out of the 50 to 2,000 to 250,000, that would also allow all the departments the flexibility to determine how complex of a proposal they need. It may not be a project that requires a 30-page proposal, but it would give the departments the flexibility to decide that and tell the people who are providing their proposals what they expect to see. One other item was on the pre-qual list. Currently, the purchasing department reviews the pre-qualifications and brings them forward to the mayor for final approval. In the amendment, it would require the mayor and the city council to approve those pre-quals. So just that's kind of a change that I guess a question is, what happens if you all don't agree? The mayor and the city council don't agree. There's nothing in this that outlays a process for what that would look like.
1 minute.
Reporting is great, and that's a good way to provide that transparency that I think you're all seeking. One thing that we would just bring up is, as the amendment is written out, it would require all projects that are under consideration for future work. That seems very broad and seems like a lot of work for the city staff to be able to bring something to you that maybe they're even considering or thinking about. So that is pretty broad, might need to look at ways that maybe we could confine that a little bit. And then the last thing that I wanted to bring up that is a change from the current EO is in the pre-qual and in the 250,000 and over proposals, there would now be a requirement to designate whether you're a veteran, minority, woman-owned, those types of things. And that wasn't in the current process, the current EO process. And if that's for tracking, that would be a great thing to do after the proposals are awarded and you've got the contracts, you could collect that information. But it might, in our mind and some of the legal folks that we've talked to, it comes a little dangerously close to affirmative action. So I just want to throw that out so we all take a look at that.
Questions? Larian.
You raised this issue of smaller businesses feeling like they perhaps wouldn't compete if they have a written proposal to submit, whether it's staff that they don't have to do it or the time. is that feedback you've gotten from businesses you've talked to, and do you foresee that meaning that the city will have fewer options, fewer choices of who to do business with? Is that the implication?
I think that's a fair summation of that. And we have talked to, we represent member firms from one person in their office to thousands. And our small firms committee is always very concerned about obstacles to doing business and to having the opportunity to get their foot in the door, if you will. So by not having to do a significant proposal like this, they can do them, but they're very expensive. They're as qualified, they're as able, they can make these proposals, but the burden on them is much greater. And so they probably, I would say they would likely be not as willing to put in a proposal on something that's $50,000 fee, because they're gonna spend $10,000 or $8,000 to win a $50,000 proposal. So I think you would see maybe less proposals.
Okay, thank you.
John.
Just in comment or response on that, one of the reasons for having that is if where it is now, that if it's under 100,000 now or under my proposed 50, there the department head only has to talk to one firm, just make a phone call. This helps broaden it because now we're involving at least three. And so the idea was to further competition, and we're going to look at some things on the definition of written and so forth. But and I appreciate your input, but I felt it was important to encourage broader consideration rather than less, and be restrictive and ensure accountability and openness so that we know that the firms out there, there is consideration being made, and just, and it's an accountability. So, but I appreciate your input on that.
Sure, and there might be a way to broaden that without the burdensome requirement of full proposals.
And I might note too, I forgot to say in the prologue too, I had originally had it where anything over $50,000 cumulative in a 2-year biennium that we would approve, and mm-hmm. I totally dropped that out of this measure. I had increased it a $250,000, but then I dropped it out with the concurrence of some of my colleagues. And so this is really gravitated to really an openness type of reporting measure, and I kind of use the acronym PACT, process, accountability, communication, and transparency. And I think that overall is going to be very beneficial to the private sector as well as to the city, and in bringing that executive order into codification, I think will help everybody as well. So thank you, and I appreciate your input because you were very invaluable at several meetings.
Other questions? All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Anyone else wishing to speak, please come forward.
Pam Dingman. I am the county engineer, although I am not here on an official county engineer discussion today. Pam Dingman, 1021 D Street. I'm the owner of Engineering Design Consultants, a small engineering company. As well as another company. I'd just like to say, as a small company, I networked and marketed with the City of Lincoln for over 10 years. Qualification-based selection often excluded me from projects over $200,000 in fee. Projects that in some cases, my small engineering company had designed and constructed all the private improvements in a subdivision, but yet were not considered qualified to do trails or other city projects through the subdivision. Under $250,000 projects, my small company over 10 years was asked to present a proposal twice. However, we were not selected. Under the $100,000 area, we actually received two projects totaling less than $20,000 in a 10-year period. Ms. McCullough stated that disclosing ownership creates affirmative action issues. You know, it's also been discussed that disclosing firm ownership, whether it be veteran, minority, or woman-owned, is perhaps a challenge to qualifications-based selection. But I would like to ascertain that qualifications-based selection should not be used as a reason to exclude women and minority and veteran-owned firms. Now, in saying that, I would also like to say I'm not an attorney, but I believe Amendment 424 from a few years ago excluded goals on government contracts. at the state and federally funded levels, or at the state and local levels. However, the exception is if there's federal dollars involved. So, for example, a few years ago when I proposed on the 11th Street Corridor project, I did have to disclose in my proposal that I was woman-owned and certified with Department of Roads as a federal requirement, which I did do. Several years ago, I assisted the City of Omaha in the creation of a small business program with two tiers, one for small business and one for small businesses located in impoverished business districts. I would encourage the city to seek a contracting system that encourages the growth of small, locally owned companies and embraces diversity. Since being appointed and elected to the office of county engineer, I have not pursued and I will not pursue or respond to City of Lincoln work of any kind while I'm in public office. However, I believe it's important to make the City of Lincoln and Lancaster County a community of opportunity for all. I further believe that modern economic growth and the retention of our best and brightest minds requires us embracing diversity in all areas, and especially in all areas of contracting. Diversity has many economic benefits, including, at sometimes, lower overhead on engineering contracts. Discussing these types of projects is never easy, and I will assure you that I pondered long and hard before I came to talk to you today. I know there has been a lot of discussion over the years about engineering contracting, and I'm truly humbled and thankful for your thoughtful consideration of this. Incidentally, in Lancaster County, I'm authorized to contract engineering in $3,000 increments.
Questions?
Are there any questions?
John.
Yeah, if I may, Ms. Dingman, relating your experience to what you just testified, and I assume you've had an opportunity to read what I've put forth, do you have some suggestions, or is that, and basically I did list those four categories of, for example, woman-owned, minority, and so forth. For the purposes of information, and I just felt that that was very important, that a city of the size Lincoln has grown to and all, that we ought to have that. It's not a criteria by any means, but that was my purpose, and I had several other individuals encourage me to do that. So any other suggestions you have?
I know that there has been some additional discussion today on this. I haven't had a chance to look at the new amendments that were put up today, and I would like to just look at it in its entirety with suggested amendments. I think my concern is that, you know, we always want to make sure that we're following the letter of the law. And Amendment 424 did make some changes to contracting, in particular, anything that looks like a goal. Is not allowed in the state of Nebraska or at the local level. Anything that looks like a goal in regards to women or minority ownership.
Yeah, and that wasn't my purpose. It was just purely information.
And just cautionary.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak this evening? All right, since we have a motion that's been seconded by Roy, we can go ahead and vote on the delay for 1 week with continued public hearing. Is that correct, John?
Yes.
All right, we'll go ahead and call the roll on that.
Camp?
Yes.
Christensen?
Yes.
Eskridge?
Yes.
Fellers?
Yes.
Gaylor Baird?
Yes.
Lamb?
Yes.
Rebold?
Yes.
Motion carried 7-0. That concludes our public hearing, and we can move into the voting session. Public hearing resolutions. Item 17 is the preliminary engineering services agreement supplement number 2 with Alfred Benish and Company. This was introduced by Raybould.
So moved.
Second.
Second by Carl. Discussion. Okay, call the roll.
Camp?
Yes.
Christensen?
Yes.
Eskridge?
Yes.
Fellers?
Yes.
Gaylor Baird?
Yes.
Lamb?
Yes.
Raybould?
Yes.
Motion carried 7-0. Item 18 is preliminary engineering services agreement supplement number 3 with Alfred Benish, introduced by Raybould.
So moved.
Second.
Seconded by Carl. Discussion. Okay, call the roll.
Camp?
Yes.
Christensen?
Yes.
Eskridge?
Yes.
Fellers?
Yes.
Gaylor Baird?
Yes.
Lamb?
Yes.
Raybould?
Yes.
Motion carried 7-0.
Item 19 is approving the second amendment to the interlocal agreement between the city and county regarding Keno Human Services Prevention Fund guidelines, introduced by Raybould.
So moved.
Second.
Seconded by Carl. Discussion.
I would just add that as... Oh.
Cindy.
Thank you.
Sorry, Cindy.
That's okay. I just wanted to say that I am so supportive of this and putting this on an annual basis. I think that we ran into run into times when organizations maybe don't have the right things in place in order to go through or take advantage of the process in 1 year, that may change into the second year. And so I plan to fully support this, and I'm very grateful for Sarah doing the investigation she did.
Okay.
Well, and another little tweak to it had to do with using the language of early childhood development, not just youth, and also allowing a percentage, identifying a percentage of the funds that could be used for administrative costs, and therefore, you know, indicating that more of this money needs to be spent on programs that directly benefit people in the community. So again, I likewise am supportive of this change.
All right, other comments? Okay, call the roll, please.
Camp?
Yes.
Christensen?
Yes.
Eskridge? Fellers?
Yes.
Gaylor Baird?
Yes.
Lamb?
Yes.
Raybould?
Yes.
Motion carried, 7-0. Public hearing ordinances second reading are items 20 through 25. 6 has been delayed 1 week with continued public hearing. No ordinances third reading. Resolutions for action only. Item 27 is adopting the Lincoln Electric System annual budget for 2016 to become effective January 1st, 2016. Introduced by Gaylor Baird.
So moved.
Second.
By Carl. Discussion. Carl.
If the camera were to pan out in this room, it would tell something pretty loud about the good job that LES and the LES board has done in this with no rate increases and moving to about 50% of energy being created with renewable sources. Strongly in favor of this motion. Thank you.
Other discussion? Let the record show the camera did pan.
Beautiful CFO.
Yeah.
For,
let's call the roll.
Camp?
Yes.
Christensen?
Yes.
Eskridge?
Yes.
Fellers?
Yes.
Gaylor Baird?
Yes.
Lamb?
Yes.
Raybould?
Yes.
Motion carried, 7-0. Item 28, then, is adopting the Lincoln Electric System rate schedules to become effective January 1st, 2016. Introduced by Gaylor Baird.
So moved.
Second.
Seconded by Carl. Discussion. Okay, call the roll, please.
Camp?
Yes.
Christensen?
Yes.
Eskridge?
Yes.
Fellers?
Yes.
Gaylor Baird?
Yes.
Lamb?
Yes.
Raybould?
Yes.
Motion carried, 7-0. Resolutions on first reading are items 29 through 35. Ordinances first reading are items 36 through 43.
And Mr. Chair, I'd move for adjournment.
Second.
Seconded by Jane. Call the roll, please.
Camp?
Yes.
Christensen?
Yes.
Eskridge?
Yes.
Fellers?
Yes.
Gaylor Baird?
Yes.
Lamb?
Yes.
Raybould?
Yes.
Motion carried, 7-0.
We're adjourned.
452.